Hi, I'm Parker Dahl.
And I'm Warren Eickhoff.
And welcome to So What?
A place where we ask the questions on the mind of many of our students, so what?
Why am I even here? I absolutely do not need to learn about absolutism. I'm living it.
What? How'd you do that? Yeah, well, at least you're eating real food this time. The following are but some of the answers to these questions, and as always, you should do your own research.
Today, we will talk about the age of absolutism.
Specifically, the development of European rivalries impacting the globe.
The first thing you need to know is that, well, Europe was living through a time that had a lot of change.
New innovations made it possible to sail to the far reaches of the world.
New connections to land and trade networks will expand Europeans' conception of what the world is.
Developing European economies will seek to dominate different portions of the world's trade networks.
These nations will see an incredible influx of wealth.
But why did these countries covet these trade networks so much?
They were operating on the basis of an economic system known as mercantilism.
Under mercantilism, a nation's wealth is measured by how many precious metals it has.
Raw materials could be used by countries to produce products, which could then be exported to other countries in exchange for money. This was how most countries planned to improve their wealth.
That's right. This economic principle also stated that the economy was a zero-sum game. The only way to succeed would be to take wealth from another country.
You can think of it like a pie.
Did you say pie?
Calm down. It's just an example. Now, let's imagine that this pie is split into 8 different pieces.
What kind of pie? You got some oak?
I don't know. Like pecan pie.
Can it be like blueberry or pumpkin?
It doesn't matter.
It does matter.
Anyway, if there are 8 pieces of pie, then that means that, well, roughly 8 people can have a slice of pie. But the thing is that Mr. Eickhoff apparently really likes pie. So he's going to take 4 different slices. And that means that, well, at least 3 other people will go without a slice of pie. That is what it means to have a zero-sum game.
I love pie. Oh my gosh, I'm so excited. Thanksgiving's so close.
We now know that this just isn't true. Economies grow and shrink based on many different factors.
This is important to note because countries will do everything they can to get as many slices of pie as possible. Like a pumpkin slice, a cherry slice, a mud pie slice, oh, and an apple pie slice.
Eickhoff, stop it with the pie already. Now, many European countries are going to see a consolidation of power within their monarchies. One reason for this is, well, that monarchs are really good at making quick, decisive action.
Oh, flip their heads!
This helped fuel the rivalry between nations and further entrench the ideals of mercantilism where it was every country for themselves.
See here, son. So what?
What do you mean?
On principle, I never say anything that another person is obviously trying to get me to say. The less I know about other people's affairs, the happier I am. I'm not interested in caring about people.
Well, I guess we should go back and see how people make decisions. Let's go back to France in the year 1680. Hello, random kingly individual. Can you please tell me how you make decisions for your country?
I just do. It helps that God chose me to be king, and as such, any decision I make must be God's decision.
Okay. But do you ever take advice from people?
I will allow my advisors to share their thoughts from time to time. It is important for nobles to feel important sometimes.
I was actually talking about the peasants.
You consider peasants to be people? What is wrong with you? Out of my sight at once, or off with your head.
I always ask one too many questions. As you can see, monarchs believe that they led by divine right.
In fact, Louis XIV is going to be the quintessential example of an absolute monarch. He will create a massive standing army.
Which was something that countries didn't do before.
He will expand colonial territories to extract raw materials.
Because France was using them to win the mercantilism fight.
And he is perhaps best known for having moved his court to his hunting cabin, the Palace of Versailles.
Oh yeah, All hunting cabins look like this in Alaska. This time period is particularly confusing to people nowadays, because we have a current mindset that some form of democracy is the preferred form of government. But we never stop to ask what advantages monarchies might actually give to their countries.
Europe had experienced moments of instability caused by both human action and natural environmental forces. It is hard to respond to disasters when a group has to debate something.
Whereas a single ruler can be decisive.
He was born and raised to rule. No one has ever been this cruel. In a thousand years of aristocracy.
It is something that will allow for France to not only respond to natural disasters, but regional conflicts as well.
It's also very difficult for a group of people to appeal to the masses. There are too many different personalities and things get complicated really quickly. People really don't like complicated things.
Having one person in charge? There's nothing complicated about that. This can lead to a cult of personality, where the people sort of treat their leader as if they're a god. This is certainly going to be the case with Louis XIV.
Of course it will. That's the whole point of the divine right of kings.
Yeah, I know, but I...
Do you ever even listen when I'm talking?
Yes, but I was going...
It's like you don't even care. Ugh.
I was trying to say that many people will actually criticize some French policies, but they will not criticize Louis XIV. Instead, they'll turn their criticism to the advisors around Louis, because, like, the king can't be wrong, so it must be them.
I still haven't heard an apology, or any downsides to absolute monarchy.
I'm sorry that you feel like I did something wrong. The downside to absolute monarchy is that it depends on the person who's in power.
You could have a fantastic, benevolent leader that is just perfect.
Oh yeah.
Or you can have the worst, least educated ruler that literally worships a potato.
Potato.
While these are obviously exaggerated in some regards, the truth is these people have to make decisions. And when those decisions are made by one person alone, and it's a really complex thing, no doubt they're going to miss one piece of the critical thinking process.
While a group may be slower at making decisions, that's for a reason. They're usually arguing with each other to produce the best possible outcome.
Because contrary to the mindset of absolute monarchs, nobody is perfect.
Speak for yourself.
Well, maybe if Louis was open to discussions, he would have seen the economic situation his people were in!
Really? A hedgehog? I shall keep it, and name him Reginald. Anyways, Louis XIV didn't address those issues, and they only got worse over the decades. The results of which we will talk about in a few weeks.
Well, one of the ways to be more sure in our actions is to educate ourselves.
And surround ourselves with the educated people to discuss such actions.
Fine. Enjoy the fact that your royal overlords are a frail old woman and a tiny baby.
Peasants are people. How ridiculous. Carl, make sure that noble is never allowed to present me with my nightshirt again.
Okay, Your Majesty, but I really think you need to take a look at some of these bread prices.
Oh, shut up, Carl. What concerns the price of bread to me?
Bread. He's totally got bread up there. Yeah, let's get the bread.
Wait a minute. This castle's the other way.